And we are live. It is Off Planet TV. I'm Randy Moggins. It is July the 8th, 2015. We're broadcasting through the offices of Conscious Consumer Network, CCN. That's consciousconsumernetwork.tv on the internet. And you can find us at offplanetradio.com and offplanetmedia.net. And we're probably just spin dizzy tonight, and you'll probably see some of that bleed through as my guests and I engage. We are broadcasting from the Zionist-occupied East Coast of the United States, the land of shame, the ruins of America, as we end the summer season of the Supreme Court, the august Supreme Court of the United States, equaled in shame only by the POTUS, the president of the U.S., and by the stupidity of the American people who continue to endorse ridiculous ideas like a Supreme Court mandate for gay marriage and taking the Confederate flag down from the State House in South Carolina. Is this like the land of the ludicrous or what? Well, we're going to find out. I have with me tonight somebody who speaks to things on a very broad scale and yet brings to the table a definitive understanding of the issues that we talk about every day. He comes from a background that is diverse and lends credence to being truly an inside observer. Several years ago, he woke up, and when he woke up, he was like a lot of us. He hurt and he was pissed off, and he decided to do something about it. And so he began what is now known as the Liberty Beacon Project, a multifaceted outreach to the United States and the world on the scale of truth. I want to introduce my guest tonight from the Liberty Beacon, Mr. Roger Landry. Welcome.
It's always great to talk with you, Randy.
Yeah, a lot of people probably, well, if they don't know now, they will by the end of this show tonight realize that we're colleagues, we're friends, we've spent a lot of time getting to know each other, and you've graciously consented to be on the show tonight on video, which is something you don't very often do, and no. I'm very happy to see your face, and I'm very happy to have you here.
Well, I'll tell you something. I'll give you the short list of things I won't do for you, Randy. Would you like to hear it again?
As long as they don't mention anything with me in a state of disrobe.
No. Oh, God, no. Oh, now, see, I'm going to spend the rest of this 2 hours trying to get that thought out of my mind. I do appreciate the gracious introduction, but I think you understated it. For any of your listeners who are unaware, and there might be some listening tonight who are aware of the Liberty Beacon Project, I spent 30 years working for the system itself. I spent 30 years working for the Department of Defense via the military industrial complex. I worked for Raytheon as a projects programs manager, a senior systems engineer, senior field engineer. What I did was I spent between 75 and 80% of my life for 28 years outside of this country, traveling from base to base, from ship to ship, wherever there were issues that needed to be solved. So when I woke up a couple of years ago, I woke up from a situation where I was probably the preeminent neocon most of you would ever meet in your life. Nobody who listens to Randy's show or is part of the Liberty Beacon Project today would have liked me 5 years ago. Fox News was on 24/7 in my house, and when I was finally awoken by the by an extreme effort of a very good friend, I spent 2 weeks locked in my bedroom in my apartment, and a lot of it had to do with shedding tears and realizing that the world was not as I had perceived it. Well, let me tell you something. Finding out you were wrong, or finding reality after so many years of thinking what you were doing was absolutely right, will either tear your world apart, or it will bring you to reality, and it will lift you up in a magnificent fashion. I have experienced both, Randy.
Yeah, and you know, actually, Roger, you did it in a much faster clip than many of us. I mean, for a lot of us, It's been this slow, arduous process. I call it the slow grinding effect that happens as you just go, oh, no, not that. You're kidding me. Really?
Yeah.
There was a single shooter? There wasn't a single shooter in Dallas? No. And then you go, oh, my God, the World Trade Center wasn't brought down by jet fuel. And and eventually, yeah. You know, it's for a lot of us, it's a long process. I mean, really, on one level, for anybody that's got a heart for the truth, eventually it's going to catch up with us. And what we do with it then is the responsibility. And as I said in my intro tonight, you really did step into the game in a big way in what you did. Let's talk a little bit about what the Liberty Beacon is, how it functions, and the outreach that you're doing, which is on many different levels as well, Roger.
Well, let's start at a basic level, which is always good. It's good to lay a foundation, and then we'll build upon that. The foundation of the Liberty Beacon Project is two things, two very, very simple things. The first thing is, if you go to anybody's website or you go to any organization's mission statement, what you will see is either multiple, very long paragraphs, and I'm not telling you they're not worth it, in a lot of cases they are, but it's lengthy, or anywhere up to a small book. We have the shortest mission statement on the planet, but I think it probably says as much as any mission statement out there. The mission of the Liberty Beacon Project is the eradication of programmed ignorance. That's it in a nutshell. Because I will tell you that a vast majority of what this world suffers today is due to a massive program of keeping us all ignorant. I don't believe that a massive majority of the world is stupid. But I do believe that we are the most ignorant society ever to exist on this planet, and this is choreographed. All right, so what is our goal? This is our mission. What is our goal? Our goal is to push back against anything, and I do mean anything, that harms humanity. Physically or mentally. This includes geoengineering, this includes vaccines, this includes GMOs, biotoxins, it includes fluoride, it includes drugs. Because let's put things into perspective. Yes, this project started in America, and what we found out very, very quickly is that the world suffers, everything America suffers, but it's all on slightly different wavelengths. What passes for liberty and tyranny in one country also passes for liberty and tyranny in another country, but it's on a slightly different wavelength. They perceive things differently. So we initially focused on the United States, and we started building websites across the planet, and we've got quite a few of those. So what we have is America. Now, let's stop and consider that I am 60 years old, and I have no problems and no qualms telling anybody this. I'm 60 years old. I was born in 1954. I was born into what we considered at that time, when I was a kid, the freest, healthiest and most vibrant societies on the planet. Today, almost exactly three generations later, 90% of what we perceived as rights and freedoms and inalienable rights have evaporated. And we can go into that a little bit more after I get through this scenario. Also, let's go into the health issue. When I was born into one of the healthiest, if not the healthiest and most vibrant societies on the planet. Today, America is the sickest, and a lot of people push back when I say that, but let me explain and qualify that. We have the highest levels of cognitive dysfunction on the planet. Now, when I say cognitive dysfunction, I'm talking about brain damage. What is it? What do I mean by cognitive dysfunction? I mean Alzheimer's. I mean dementia. I mean ADHD. I mean autism. I mean, and I could go on listing them, because every time a psychiatrist wakes up on the wrong side of the bed, he invents another one. United States of America suffers the highest levels of cognitive dysfunction, the highest levels of autoimmune disease, the highest levels of food allergies, and I could go on. So let me tell you why. The United States of America is the most geoengineered, is the most vaccinated, is the most GMO'd, is the most fluoridated, is the most drugged society on the planet. Now, if only one or two of these was happening, I could stand back and look and say, man, those people are really screwed up. We got to focus on them. We got to do something about this. But the American society is being attacked with multiple prongs simultaneously and continuously. Is there any doubt why America is one of the most dumbed down and ignorant societies on the planet today? And we can also go into that a little bit in a little bit more detail later. But would you agree with what I've stated so far, Randy? I can't hear you.
You enumerated it real well. I mean, we're starting with the basic fact that functionally we're sick as, as a culture, and we're sick from the very people who were supposed to be in charge of our health. As somebody put it, doctors kill, lawyers lie, judges judge unrighteously. And that is just scratching the surface of what's going on in this country.
And politicians give them all the tools they need to do exactly, that.
Yeah.
Okay. When Princeton University publishes a study, which they did in the last part of 2014, stating that the United States of America is no longer ruled in a democratic process, but is indeed under the rule of oligarchy. When Princeton releases a study saying this, how many people have pushed back against this? Where's the huge uproar? To me, the street should have been flooded with patriots saying, are you freaking kidding me?
Yeah. I mean, all you need to know is to look at the media right now and see what they don't cover. The constant dog and pony show that they call news, and all of the issues that you, my friend, cover every day on the Liberty Beacon, are swept under the rug, and we're given stories about Bruce Jenner's sex change, and we're entertained with Kim Kardashian's ass, and we're supposed to care about these knaves that are basically sitting in front of us on the boob tube. As Don Henley once said, the bubble-headed bleached blonde, she can tell you about the plane crash with the gleam in her eye. Well, that's what we have for media. So on one level, again, programmed ignorance, willful stupidity, the fact that the American people, and I'm picking on America specifically because, quite frankly, as goes America, goes the rest of the Western culture.
But you know what? Not only do you realize that, do I realize that, and a lot of people who do some great work within the Liberty Movement realize that, but the rest of the world realizes that. Because again, I've told you I did extensive travel across this planet, and one of the things I saw and I heard from so many of my friends across the planet is, what is happening to America? Let me explain something to you. Okay. And again, a lot of people realize this, but they probably haven't gone into the depths that you and I of this rabbit hole. We have traveled down this rabbit hole a lot further, you and I, than most people have. What needs to be understood is why the rest of the world is focusing on America, why the rest of the world is looking to see what America is going to do. Let me explain to you. It has been said over and over again by agents of this New World Order, which I hate that term, but it's the one most people understand, have constantly said over and over again in areas like CFR meetings or Bilderberg meetings that the United States of America must be brought to its knees before the New World Order can truly take hold on this planet. And when people ask why, it's because we're the cowboys. It's because we believe in freedom. It's because we believe that the process of liberty should belong in the hands of us individuals. We are the government of the United States of America. Well, not too much today. We've acquiesced a lot of that power, but that's something that you and I are moving to change. That's one of our goals, is to bring people back to the realization that we sit at the top of the totem pole, not the oligarchs who have absconded with our seats. So the rest of the world is looking to see if America drops to her knees, then they will realize nothing that they can do or will do will make a difference, and they will give up MSA. But if the United States pushes forward and says, we will retain our sovereignty, we will retain our individuality, we will retain our right to liberty, freedom, and the pursuit of happiness, then the rest of the world will dance. And they will join on that bandwagon with us. And this is why the New World Order is terrified of America, and why they insist we go to our knees before they can tell the world they have succeeded in bringing in the New World Order.
We're right now like the neutered dog on the block. And yet at the same time...
yes.
A lot of people were cheering for that dog to get back its virility because it's... it's really crucial.
Yes.
I'm looking at Texas right now with great hope. Some of the things that are being done behind the scenes, including the request for the return of the gold bullion that is owned by the University of Texas, is a hopeful sign that perhaps the people down there, including their governor, are looking at things like Jade Helm, the recent recent Supreme Court decisions, and the general state of malaise across the rest of the country. Frankly, there's some pockets, but I'm looking at Texas right now and I'm going, stand up. If you do it, other people will stand up behind you. What's your take on that?
Well, not only do I agree with you, but we're starting to see movements like this germinating across the country. In California right now, they just passed a bill, which is SB 277, and Brown signed it into law. That means in order to go to school, your children must receive every single vaccine that the government decides you must have. Well, a lot of parents have done a massive amount of research. I have done a massive amount of research. I realize, and this is another topic I won't delve into deeply because it would take up the entire 2 hours, that a lot that goes on in the vaccine industry is centered only on profit for the vaccine industry. But if you go back to the late 1700s, when Thomas Jefferson said, when the people decide to let the government decide what foods they eat and what medications they put into their bodies, their souls will eventually become as sickly as the tyranny they suffer. So if you go to California right now, one of the biggest perpetrators of passing this bill was a senator called Richard Pan. They are recalling him. And as soon as they get done recalling him, they're going to start recalling every single senator and congressman in the congressional process in the state of California. So the people of California have woken up and said, you are not going to force tyranny on us. We will decide what medications go into our body, and we will decide what schools our children go into. So we see this in California. We see this going on. New Hampshire has come out and done a few things lately that have absolutely surprised me, but New Hampshire has always had testicular fortitude. I don't accredit to a lot of states. Right. What we are seeing is an awakening across this country. A recent poll, last part of 2014, states that well over 65% of all of the American people, I don't care if it's Democrats, Republicans, Tea Party, libertarians, over 65% of the population in the United States of America today are fed up with the actions of this government. That has never happened before. Something is changing, Randy.
All we need to do right now is look at the movements that are being made on every level by our government towards our people to realize that, and truthfully, the American people right now should be, while they should be pissed off first and scared as well of what is being launched against them. And again, I point to Jade Helm. I fixate on it mainly because, to me, it basically is the poster child for the forward movement of the military-industrial complex. I don't know how many people have seen the document. This has been leaked onto the internet. It's the Department of Defense Law of War Manual from June 2015. And I'm going to upload this to my website. You'll be able to get a link from that when this show goes out. This is a chilling document in terms of what it details on how the military is to comport themselves towards the American citizenry. This is the most sweeping piece of military law that we have seen since right before the Civil War. And it is a state of declared war against the American people.
Well, and again, we have to track back to the part where we talk about the ignorance of the American people. I'm not one to say stupidity, because I believe once we wake them up, we can supplant them ignorance with knowledge. But we look at the ignorance of the American people. What most people do not realize is that this country has been in the state of emergency, and basically the state of martial law, since the early 1930s, for over 80 years. And a lot of the things that we scream about and we say, that's unconstitutional, you can't do that, Congress, or you can't do that in an executive order, Mr. President, what they're not realizing, and what most presidents won't come out and tell you, even though as soon as they get into the White House, they have to sign a continuation of that state of emergency, so they all know it exists, they're all very aware of it. A lot of the things that are perpetrated by our presidents and our Congress who are aware of this state do fall within the realm of the state of emergency. But since they don't want to come out and tell you and me that our liberties are not intact, because the United States is, in fact, in a state of emergency, or basically a state of martial law for the last 80 years, then they allow us to argue amongst ourselves about the constitutionality of things wherein the Constitution, in most cases today, has no place.
Yeah, well, that is the sadness of it all, mainly because of the conversion that was done during the Reconstruction period of after the Civil War.
Yes.
Most people have not been studied. You and I grew up in the same time period.
Yes.
You and I grew up with history, with civics, and all of these courses in our public school system that failed to deliver a true analysis of that period of time. The Civil War was deliberately mistaught to people
Yes.
in our generation. Why? Because we were close enough to the original generations. There were actually people alive when we were children who remembered. And the eradication of history is one of the most important processes that they use to basically dumb us down. You know, my grandfather was born in 1898, so he lived within 40 years of the Civil War. You think his father, you think that his relatives, the people who were alive in that time, didn't know the true history of the United States at that period? And now we're seeing it again with them taking the Confederate flag down, with this political correctness as a result of what, you know, if we can believe what was portrayed by our snooze media, was an unfortunate shooting in a church in South Carolina as a pretext to send in a mob of rioters to the state house and demand the takedown of the Confederate flag. Again, we're dealing with symbolism, but the symbolism is important because of what that stands for. The idea that the Civil War was fought over slavery is one of the things that were mistaught to this generation and every other generation, and it is the pretext to wipe history.
It was states' rights. States' rights was the reason for the Civil War. And it wasn't slavery. As a matter of fact, Lincoln has been quoted several times in some of his addresses as stating that if I can do this, I will do this as well. Meaning it wasn't the preeminent point. But what we need to also understand, what has never been taught, was the biggest tyranny, and you hit on it in the time frame you're talking about. Okay, let's go back to the time of Lincoln. Let's go back to right after Lincoln. Let's talk about the biggest tyranny ever committed against the United States of America, and something that is never, ever taught in public schools. You can go into any history book, any political science book, you will never see mention of the fact that in 1871, the United States was sold to a bunch of private bankers across the planet. The United States became a corporation. The United States became ruled by a foreign power which occupies Washington, D.C., which is not part of the United States of America. So what most people don't understand is that our laws are not maritime laws. Our common laws, our laws are maritime laws. Our laws are illegal. Our form of government is illegal because it owes allegiance to a foreign power, which is Washington, D.C. The United States hasn't been a republic since 1871. It is, in fact, a corporation. Mm-hmm. This, you know, although they never taught it to us, Randy, I can throw proof after proof after proof at anybody who pushes back against this. It's not hard to discover the facts. But when you bury it so deep that it's never even taught in the schools, most people don't even have a clue they should be looking for it. That is the biggest tyranny ever committed against the American people in the history of this country, in 1871, when America was sold.
I think this is where we insert the Landry challenge.
I do not ever challenge anybody to prove what I say is wrong. I dare you to prove me wrong. If I'm saying it, especially if I'm saying it with angst or bravado, then obviously I have done the homework, and I welcome any challenge.
And that's you've stated that on every show I've ever heard you on, with great emphasis and with great glee, because the fact of the matter is that every day readers can get up, go to the Liberty Beacon, and find massive amounts of information that continue to bolster the views that we're talking about on a wide spectrum of things. And yes, I am promoting the Liberty Beacon tonight because I'm part of it.
Yes,
I'm very, very proud of the work that is done there. Like every other independent media outlet right now, including our friends here at CCN, it's a struggle. There are times when we falter. There are times when we have our Snoopy dance in the end zone. Most of the time, it is putting nose to grindstone and finger to keyboard and finding the truth that's not being reported by the mainstream news. So I've said that as basically props to all my friends in independent media who I'm proud to be a part of. One of the things that the Liberty Beacon has covered extremely, and you touched on it earlier, and I think it bears a bullet point all of its own right now, is the vaccine issue. You have obviously very deep contacts with people at very high levels, people that we consider to be whistleblowers.
Yes.
People who bring out strategic information that is actively suppressed by the media, by the government, by anybody who, well, basically by the gatekeepers. One of those whistleblowers is Dr. David Lewis, whom you've interviewed and you've featured articles by, and he has disclosed exactly what's going on at the CDC and their culpability in terms of the vaccines that are being pushed onto the American public.
I one of my latest articles, and it's on the Liberty Beacon right now. One of my latest articles was Vaccines, A Century of Lies and Deceit. And it has been, the United States started to become vaccinated with any real push right after the right after World War I with the Spanish-American flu, or the Spanish flu. And that was in 1917, 1918, 1919, when we were suffering this malady. And there was a huge push to vaccinate the American population. And what we found out that was that as many, if not more, people died from the vaccines as died from the flu itself. So we carry forward from there. Yes, Dr. David Lewis is a PhD level microbiologist. He spent 32 years as one of the lead researchers for the CDC. He fell out of favor with the CDC when he started to write papers and articles depicting the corruption he was seeing within the structure of an agency whose mandate it is to protect our health. And so they basically decided, in order to protect or cover their own ass, they had to do something with them. Well, it's very, very hard to fire a federal worker. So they made an agreement with him, and they bought him out, and he retired. David works very closely with the Liberty Beacon Project. Basically, he is our science director for health issues. And I have done 4 radio shows with him. He's written some articles with us. We've co-authored a few articles. And David's research area was on biotoxins and their effect on you and me, how they were poisoning us. Now, David will be the first one to tell you that the corruption level and the revolving door within these agencies of the government, meaning the USDA, the FDA, the CDC, the EPA, all of them are as corrupt as the last. There is no shining star there. They are all, and here's a real popper for everybody listening. Not only is the United States of America a corporation, but the CDC, the FDA, the EPA, these are all traded on Dun and Bryant Street. They are all privately owned corporations. Okay? So
do your research.
Do your research. But he wrote a book as soon as he left government service, and the title of it ought to grab you by the nads, and I guarantee if you read it, your eyes will open the size of saucer plates. The name of David's book is Science for Sale. Stop and think about that. And what he's talking about is the government. Our leaders of the FDA, the administrators, the high-ranking directors, all of the high-ranking staff, these people come from companies like Merck, like Eli Lilly. When a president comes in who they've donated a lot of money to, their directors, their presidents, whatever, move over into positions that run or facilitate immense power over these organizations. When that president gets out, if he's got a few of his own cronies to bring in, they go back to directorships or vice presidentships or whatever in these same pharmaceutical companies. One more point, and I can see you're chopping at the bit, and I really want you to come back in. One more point. For all of you out there who insanely believe that the military-industrial complex exercises the most power, sway, and authority over this government by owning the biggest portion of this government, nothing could be further from the truth. The pharmaceutical industry spends 500% more on lobbying our government than the entire military-industrial complex. 5 times what the entire military-industrial complex does. I need to tell you, the biggest influence on you and I today, the reason our health has fallen in 3 generations from the healthiest to the sickest, and the reason why pretty soon you won't be able to turn down a vaccine, you won't be able to turn down a drug, you will eat the GMOs and the fluoride will not come out of your water, is because the most powerful entity in this oligarchy, as stated by Princeton, is Big Pharma.
And let us state
see
for
what
the
you
record.
Started.
Yeah,
see
well, you know, started. It's like you light a firecracker, you toss it
yeah,
out in the field, and boom, the thing goes off. But here's my point. Again, we're going back to how history has been tweaked. The fact that these pharmaceutical companies are basically what was brought over here, or what existed pre-World War II in terms of the Nazi technology, Bayer, Merck. Do I need to go down the line of the companies? They just seem to happen to have this mildly Teutonic sound to their name, and the fact that they gained control very quickly right after World War II in this country. They brought it in. You and I, as kids, were shuttled off to public elementary schools to receive polio vaccines, the sugar cubes, the little Dixie cups that you drank.
Oh, yeah.
And we were indoctrinated with the idea that we needed to jam needles in our arms and allow people to constantly inoculate us to protect our health, when in fact what we were doing through those vaccines, through the MMR, the rubella, all of the other vaccines that they were giving us, was basically and training us to continue taking these throughout our life. Take the flu vaccine, take all the other shots they offer. Hell, you can go right down here to the drugstore, they'll give it to you for $4 because the government subsidized it.
Yep.
Why is the government subsidizing this? Well,
again, you bring up such absolutely sterling points. You really do. But it goes, again, much, much deeper than that. It does. Okay. Let's talk about the biotech industry, which is married, almost joined at the hip with the pharmaceutical industry. And we're talking about, of course, the king of the hill of the biotech industries is Monsanto. Okay. Monsanto has a product which is used globally called glyphosate. I don't know how this happened. It never should have happened. Well, it should have happened, but I can't for the life of me figure out how it slipped out. But not too long ago, the World Health Organization stepped up and said that glyphosate is considered a class 2 carcinogen. Okay? Glyphosate is one of the most toxic substances on the planet, and it is in everything you eat. If you are eating natural grains. If you are eating natural grains, okay, let me explain something to you. Do you know what they use to dry these grains that are not GMO grains? They use glyphosate to dry these grains, which means you're getting the same amount of poison or maybe even more as that GMO that was genetically engineered to live through the poisoning with the glyphosate. All right, now let's take this one step further, okay? We are looking at a company, Monsanto, and you talked about the pharmaceutical industry and where their evils lie and where they came from. Let's look at companies like Monsanto and see that they are responsible for DDT. They are responsible for glyphosate. They are responsible for Agent Orange. They are responsible for... This company was built on products that kill people. Now, at the end of the war, they had massive reserves of these chemicals. And they said, well, what are we going to do with them? We can't just get rid of these stockpiles. So what we will do is we will go in and genetically modify these chemicals. They were originally designed to have their maximum effect on plants, not human beings, or in the case of, that's herbicides, pesticides were originally designed to have the maximum effect on bugs, not human beings, whereas these original poisons were designed to have the maximum effect on human beings. So we'll go in and we'll genetically modify these chemicals. So instead of harming human beings or focusing the harm on human beings, we'll focus the harm on plants and bugs. Can I ask you a question? Do you honestly believe that these chemicals today, which might have been refocused to have their maximum harm on bugs or plants, have no harm on human beings? They were designed to kill human beings.
Yeah. That is exactly what they were designed to do, because we are in a massive eugenics program worldwide, a program that began at the beginning of the 20th century and was through conquest of two world wars and the evolution of technology, subsidized by the taxpayers, by the blood of American soldiers who fought on foreign shores, evolved to a place where we now live constantly under the umbrella of constant, and we'll just might as well just drive the truck right home into the chemtrails that are in our skies every day, that, you know, I hope more and more people are starting to look up and realize, dude, that is not a nimbus cloud at all. That thing has nasty looking.
God, I'm so glad you went there. I really am.
Because it's all in it. Look, you know that the glyphosate is working in concert. This is a binary attack on the human biology. The glyphosate is working. It collects heavy metals inside the body. Well, guess what they put into the chemtrails? Folks, aluminous oxide, barium, various biologic, mercury.
Strontium, mercury is, barium, mercury, copper, zinc.
Iridium.
Let's tie them all together. I'm going to do something that most people believe cannot be done, but I'm going to do it in a very logical fashion that I don't challenge anybody to push back against. I dare you to push back against, okay? Because I will prove it to you unequivocally. I'm going to tie vaccines, GMOs, fluoride, and chemtrails or geoengineering together in one single tie point. Now, everybody out there is going, this guy is over the hill. He's crazy. There's no way you can do this. But yes, I can. You want to know what that tie point is? That tie point is aluminum. That tie point is aluminum. And let me explain. The biggest component, an abogent, okay, of metals in all of our vaccines is aluminum. It's used as an abogent in a large majority of our vaccinations, okay? Aluminum. All right. We talk about, right now, Monsanto and some of their partners, and for everybody who tells me this isn't happening, I have the actual patents I can throw under your face. And yes, Monsanto owns or is partnering with the companies that own these patents. Monsanto is patenting plants that can grow in aluminum-saturated soil. Aluminum-saturated soil doesn't exist naturally, even though aluminum is the third most abundant metal on the planet, okay? What comes down from the sky? A vast majority of that is aluminum nanoparticles. Why is it aluminum nanoparticles? Because they tell us they're spraying the skies in order to reflect sunlight and mitigate global warming. What do they use? They use metric ton after metric ton of nano-sized particles of aluminum, which when sprayed in the upper atmosphere has a very long hang time and reflects sunlight. But anything in a gravity well, whether it's a macro particle or a nanoparticle, will eventually have to settle to the Earth. So now, here we go. We've got aluminum in the geoengineering. We've got, and as a result, saturated ground, which we're growing plants in, and our food, through its root system, sucks this aluminum out of the soil. We have also aluminum in a vast majority of the vaccines you get. Well, where does fluoride come in? Because I said fluoride, too. I tied three of them together. Here comes the fluoride, okay? When you were born, your body started to develop, and by the time you were about 1 year old, you had what was called a blood-brain barrier. That barrier is a very, very, it's a miracle of evolution. What it does is it keeps a lot of these heavy metals and poisons from passing through the bloodstream into the brain tissue. It's called a blood-brain barrier, and it does a great job in keeping a lot of metals out of your brain. So you go out and you're jogging, and you look up and you go, oh my God, they're spraying me again. And you keep jogging, and you're breathing all this aluminum in. Then you go home and you have a nice big glass of ice water, fluoridated ice water. Fluoride facilitates the movement of heavy metals such as aluminum across the blood-brain barrier, where they immediately start to slaughter brain cells. Now tell me again, I can't tie geoengineering, fluoride, GMOs, and vaccines all together in one point. And what is that point? I know what the actual catalyst is, it's aluminum. But what is the reason? Randy, you said it. It's eugenics, my friend. It's genocide, my friend. It's culling the herd.
Yeah. You look right now.
Aren't you sorry you invited me on now?
No, not at all. Not at all. No, we have a lot of different conversations on this show, but it's really one conversation. It's called Wake the Hell Up.
Yes.
And unfortunately, as we talked about at the beginning of the show tonight, that's a painful process. And it requires repetition, which is why we have to do this on a continual basis. Reinforce, put the facts out, bring some more facts out, and reinforce again, because there are people out there, as we both have been over the years, and as many of you, the listeners, have been, the folks here at CCN have been, we've been teetering on the edge of that horrible realization. And that is what drives this alternative media to the place where we have to keep hammering it. And sometimes it's not fun to talk about these things.
If a friend of yours comes up and says something you don't particularly agree with, the first time he tells you that, you're more than likely going to ignore him. The second time he comes up and tells you something, the same thing, you're more than likely going to say, look, that's ridiculous. I don't want to hear it. The third time he comes up and tells you the same thing, you're going to say, you know what? That's really getting to be obnoxious. The fourth time, you're going to get in his face and say, prove it. And he just might do that. I never let up, and I know you don't, Randy. And yes, repetition is necessary, because at the level of ignorance most Americans sit at today, telling them one time is about 99.999% ineffective.
The other side of this is, we don't have the media empires of CNN, Fox News,
not yet,
NBC. So guess what we are? We are basically, ever see ants bring down a large insect?
Oh, yes.
Well, that's what they do. That red ants, they just basically grab the sucker, bring it down, and devour it before your very eyes. Well, alternative media, the real ones, not the phonies out there. You know, we won't mention any names, Alex Jones.
Why did I know you were going to do that?
But
anyway,
the legitimate alternative media are that team of red ants bringing down the gigantic insect, devouring it one limb at a time. So the repetition is necessary. The many voices concept is necessary, which again goes back to what the Liberty Beacon is doing, because it is a platform for other people to speak through that platform in their own unique areas of expertise. And again,
boy, did you hit a nail on the head. My God, because I just took in a new contributor the other day, and this is what he said to me: tell me what I need to do, tell me what I can do, tell me what I can't do, and tell me what I should do to help. I said, first off, you've got this all wrong. I said, if you didn't have something to offer, and not the Liberty Beacon Project, I mean offer, period, we wouldn't be having this conversation. And second off, we are a platform. We are here to give you a stage and a megaphone. The Liberty Beacon Project is made up of contributors from across the planet who all have done research within their areas and all have a great word to put out. What we want to be is that big stage and that very powerful megaphone. Sure, we have people like yourself and myself and other people who help to put the project together, and I am the founder of this project, but I've written over 1,000 articles. So we have our voice within the project too. Yeah. But what does the Liberty Beacon Project do for me? It offers me a stage. What does it do for you, Randy? It offers you a stage. What does it do for Dr. David Lewis? It offers him a stage. We are, and this is the best example or the best explanation I can give anybody, we are the shiny red toolbox, okay, in your garage, sitting up on that tool bench. You don't fix your engine with your bare hands. You need a wrench, you need a socket, you need feeler gauges. Well, consider the Liberty Beacon Project to be your toolbox. You have something you need to do. You have a good idea you need to put out. Come to us and allow us to give you the mechanism to do that. That is what we're here for. Man, you just keep hitting these points on me one right after. You know me too well.
I do. And I confess to that. I know your hot buttons. But you know, that makes you, in a lot of ways, the perfect guest for me, because I don't always have the advantage of knowing people's hot buttons. My point in saying that is this: we wake up and you go through the dark night of the soul, and then you finally go to, and this is the classic question, well, what the hell do I do now? Because that ultimately is it. Now, there's two kinds of people, maybe more, but we'll use two for this example. There's the people who wake up and then they become rabid researchers, but unfortunately, they never go to action level. The other kind of people, and you would be the alpha male of this type of person, is the one that basically says, you know, God damn it, I'm tired of sitting on the fence. I want to do something. What can I do? Well, there are lots of things people can do. This is called being proactive, because independent media relies on interconnecting relationships of people who have unique and diverse talents.
Agreed.
Your talents, you listener, can be applied to any number of strategic issues. Your ability to every day get up and be a gadfly for the information that you take in may be the most strategic part of waking people up. I have watched myself with people that I work with. I have gone from being a tinfoil hat wearing conspiracy theorist to people going, oh my God, how did you know that? Well, Because
yes,
I've now done this long enough that I can do pattern matching. I can do prediction. I can yes. tell you that the economy is going to tank, as I did with people around me in 2007. Does that make me a savant? No, it makes me an astute observer of the landscape, because when you look at our economic policy, you're going, this can't sustain itself. You know, if you look under the hood just briefly, you're going to go, that engine can't run much longer. Now, we weren't counting on what they were going to do to keep it running a little bit longer, but we know that damn engine is going to blow up very soon now. So the savant's going, hey, you know, it might be a good time to think about what's going to happen on the day when the banks don't open, the grocery stores are empty, and the welfare checks don't clear anymore. Where do you want to be on that day?
Well, you don't want to be in any inner city in this country, because you are going to see mass killing in the inner cities the day that happens. Yeah. And that anybody who thinks that that's fear porn, you're absolutely wrong, and I could beat that up. But the thing of it is, you classify two different people, and I want to take that one step further. You and I are two peas in a pod when it comes to the ability to speak to multiple topics. Okay, I am invited on vaccine shows to talk about vaccines because I've written and done a lot of research on them. I'm invited on GMO shows for the same reason. I'm invited on geoengineering shows by some of the best for the same reason. To political shows, to perpetual warfare shows, to pharmaceutical shows, because I have done a lot of research on all of these. But I have a personal motto. Would you like to hear that, Randy?
Sure. Go ahead, man. Break it out.
My personal motto is, I am an expert at nothing, but I know enough about everything to have an intelligent conversation about anything. And this is what you and I need to be. We need to be the GPs. There are the experts out there, okay? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. There are the PhDs in microbiology, the PhDs in biology, the PhDs in whatever. We are the general practitioners. We know enough about everything to steer a good conversation and extract the best information for our audiences. We have a great basic foundation in knowledge. Am I an expert on anything? You will never, ever hear me say I'm an expert at anything. But it's pretty damn hard to find a subject I can't speak to intelligently. This is the role you and I play, Randy. And more I'm seeing people like that rising up in this alternative media community. And that's what it is. It's a community. People who realize that if I'm going to be effective, I've got to know something about these vaccines. I've got to know something about political tyranny. I've got to know something about economic warfare. I've got to know these things because I need to be able to have an intelligent discussion with the people I bring on my shows. I need to be able to bring the information out that those who listen to my shows need to have. So yes, you and I are GPs, my friend, and I'm proud to be one.
Everybody is an expert at something, even if it's your own life.
We would be experts at communication on some level.
And that's exactly the point. Experts are great. They acquire knowledge and then they filter it out through the system for us. And certainly people like the people that you communicate with on a regular basis, Roger, are necessary.
Yes.
My point is, in reaching out to the folks who wonder what to do with this, the first level of this is to be informed. And it doesn't take a lot, because on a daily basis, we're taking in information. It's either good information, bad information, or just worthless garbage. You know, I say, pull the damn TV set out of the wall, throw it into the trash, take your radio, shove that. Then go find new sources and find some basic texts that educate yourself. Because once you have an interest in something, you will become an expert on it. And that is really the point of where we're going in all of this, is educating people that we are drowning in experts. We are drowning in pointy-headed intellectuals, all of whom have no moral compass, all of whom are basically positioned by the capitalists as trajectories towards one thing, which is enslaving and ultimately killing us, so that they have a manageable herd of workers for their new world order utopia. And unless you want to be hamburger in that meal, then you've got to stand up. And the way you stand up is you gain knowledge, you apply knowledge, you speak knowledge, and then you go find out what the hell it is you have to do to roll up your sleeves and make this thing run.
Well, you know, I'm so tired of hearing people push back when I say that we are looked upon as cattle. But this is exactly the way over 98% of the population on this planet is looked at. The other 1%, because there is a 99%, but the other 1%, I said 98%, the other 1% are their agents who are just aware enough to fulfill all of their wishes and needs and to put their orders into a proper categorization so that the minions below them can facilitate them properly. I would tell you that if you take a look at all of the people across this planet today, we are looked at as cattle. When you put the cattle in the pen for a couple of days, you still feed them. But when you drive them into the slaughterhouse, does a tear come out of your eye?
No.
Absolutely not.
No.
So we are taken care of as long as we're useful. When our usefulness runs out, they won't shed a tear about making a majority of us disappear.
But Roger, that's really cruel. That's really cruel, Roger. Well,
how many things do we have to say? How many things? Okay. We are the sickest society. We considered ourselves to be the most technologically advanced, the most economically advanced, the most military advanced society on the planet. Today, this nation is so far past broke, it's crazy. All they're doing is kicking the can down the road. It's inevitable we will collapse. Our health is ready to collapse. Our economy, everything. The world is about to rise up against America because they're all looking at us as tyrants. Stop and think, my friends, if on this 4th of July you celebrated your freedoms in this country, you are amongst the most enslaved in this country. If you stood up and said, I live in the freest country on the planet, you are one of the most enslaved amongst us because your ignorance has shown through to people like Randy and myself.
Yeah. Yeah, there's nothing to celebrate here. You know, one of the most tragic things I've heard in recent days was a number, and the numbers, I'm not good at memorizing numbers. And presently, we have a rate of autism that is completely off scale in this country.
1 in 28 male children, 1 in 50 female children. And by the year 2000, it could be as high as 1 in 2.
Yeah, it is a tragedy to
2020.
See
Sorry.
What we've done with our children.
Yep.
And if you don't, I don't care where you are in your life, but if you don't care about the generations that come after you, then I would have to ask you, what is the state of stewardship that you hold for your life on this earth? And I mean, you know, at some point we're going to go spiritual on this. You know that. You know me.
Yes.
And sometimes that's the only place we can hit people, is to tweak the conscience and let them know that they have a moral obligation, that they inhabit this planet with millions and billions of other souls, and where we all have a mandate to take care of where we're at.
What is the litmus test of any generation? Will my children enjoy the economic freedoms I've enjoyed? Right. Will my children have the ability to live a better life than I did? Will my children have the ability to enjoy all of the rights and freedoms they're supposed to in this country? If we go by these three precepts right now, we have failed so bad, this generation,
epically,
in our litmus test. It is insane. If we don't straighten up and take stewardship of this country and our children's future, we will be leaving them a dying earth with a tyrannical government ruling over them. That's what your children have to look forward to if we don't change it now.
And we got a break coming up. We're gonna take about maybe a 5-6 minute break. You're gonna see some videos. One of those will be a video encouraging you to join Ethymart and CCN in supporting this network's outreach. And that was the light side of the conversation. When we come back, we're going to go deep with my guest, Roger Landry, here on Off Planet TV. We're going to take a bio break, and we will be back in, Biggie will let me know, but about 5 or 6 minutes. We'll see you on the other side. And we are back from the break. This is Off Planet TV. I'm Randy Moggins. You know, we take the breaks because sometimes we just need to calm down a little bit. You YouTubers out there, I got blasted over what was perceived as a 10-minute break in one of my videos. And it's like, are you a moron? Do you not know that there's this little thing? It's called a scrubber button on the YouTube player. You push it forward. It's like a fast forward button on a VCR. You're idiots. And then you bitch and you complain about people who do something because why? Well, you're NSA paid trolls, aren't you really? You're sitting in your little boiler room with your laptop getting your government check to screw with all the people that are putting the truth out. So, hey, YouTubers, I know who you are. I check IP addresses. I look at your profiles. You get eliminated when you do that kind of bullshit. Now, having said that, and having calmed down a little bit anyway, this is the second hour of Off Planet TV with my guest, Roger Landry. His website is thelibertybeacon.com. And you'll see that on the screen down there on the bottom. You see it? It's right there. Go there. Look at that.
Oh, my God. I've got to tell you something I so much enjoy.
He's such a condescending bastard, isn't he?
Well, I so much enjoy doing shows with you because if you don't throw a little bit of levity in there every once in a while, we don't want the audience going into the back room and slitting their wrists.
Well, I can't be as colorful as I am privately sometimes, but I do try to work in a little bit of bathroom humor along the way.
All right. So where did you want to...
Let's do this first. Because we're dovetailing off the last hour, and I wasn't kidding when I said that was the light side. We really do need to talk about what's coming to America. As I've said previously, I'm not a fearmonger. I'm not trying to inflict paranoia on you, but there is something coming to America. This operation called Jade Helm is simply a warm-up exercise. I don't think it's the major action, but I do think it is a tell as to what the system is preparing for, specifically in the inner cities. Now, we've seen Ferguson, we've seen Baltimore, we've seen what happened after the shootings, so-called, down in South Carolina. We know that there are instigators, there are insurgents, and there is force and counterforce going on. You're basically playing the Hegelian dialectic at all times, and we are looking at situations specifically in urban and, yes, suburban areas, which are going to become crisis centers in the United States. Roger, you and I have talked about this a lot. You're obviously in a remote location, undisclosed, and I have to say that my rear flank's a little bit exposed compared to that, but I'm not unaware of what I expect to happen. At the moment, we talked about this, what happens when the banks close, the grocery stores are empty, the debit cards don't work anymore. You have hungry, pissed off people at that point, and there are things that we need to deal with as a real scenario for that. Break it down, brother.
Well, let's lead into this with something that you opened up the second half of the show with, and that is jade helm. What is the purpose of jade helm? I do not believe, although a lot of people have discussed this, the jade helm is going to go live and all of us are going to get rounded up and thrown into concentration camps. I don't believe that's going to happen at this point in time. Having spent so much time with the military, being 30 years of my life, having worked inside the military industrial complex and inside the Department of Defense for many, many years, they never do anything for nothing, okay? But you will find that when the military does something, they do it to condition. They do it to condition their soldiers. They do it to condition their sailors. They do it to condition their pilots. But they also do it to condition the populations they interact with. We are seeing new scenarios with Jade Helm we have never seen before. Okay? We are seeing bombs being let off in inner cities of Michigan in closed down junior highs where people are coming out in the streets going, "What the hell was that?" Okay? Bombs going off because they're trying to condition populations to accept these things as at least some level of semi-normal. Okay? The same thing is happening with, they have told us that they're going to be having special forces and civilian clothes intermingling with the population, asking questions, trying to find out, pump us with information. You know, does your neighbor do strange things? Whatever, over the course of what might appear to be a normal conversation between you and a newly discovered friend or a stranger. These are situations we have never, have they done these things before in the past? Yes, but they've never told us they were going to be doing them. They just did them. Now they're telling us they're going to do them. In Florida, a couple of months ago, in May, I have videos of them marching citizens they extracted from homes across the street with their arms on each other's shoulders, their other hand on their waist, marching in a military or a prisoner, a captured prisoner lockstep. This was a scenario whereby they practiced extracting dissidents and terrorists from American cities. And they're saying, well, we're doing this so that our military will have experience on how to do this in the Middle East, such as Iraq or Afghanistan. Let me explain something to you. Nothing they're doing in American cities looks anything like what they're going to do in Iraq or Afghanistan. So that is a bunch of poppycock. They are conditioning all of us to accept these things. So what is Jade Helm? Jade Helm is a conditioning tool more than anything else. Be aware of it. Understand that these things that they wish you to believe are normal or semi-normal are nothing of the such. They are illegal, they are unconstitutional, and they come right in where posse comitatus should be screaming its head off. Now, I'm going to take a breath and let you say something before I go into the inner cities. What do you think of that, Randy?
Well, I believe that the perception out there is that Mr. Well, we call him Bathhouse Barry, but you would know him as Barack Hussein Obama. very nicely put posse comitatus to rest.
Yes.
On New Year's Eve 2011 when he signed in the National Defense
Authorization
and, Act. And DAA Authorization Act. The truth of the matter is that these executive orders are a slippery slope as well. They simply create the illusion of power where, in fact, they cannot trump the Constitution. But the conditioning that's been done since 9/11 is actually the big game. We were given I hate the term false flag. We were given a theatrical event in which, unfortunately, thousands of people died horribly. And we watched in shock as one of our landmarks came down before our very eyes and then was looped continuously in front of us for 2 days while we lived in a state of fear and dread. That was done to install a program called post-traumatic stress syndrome that then enabled them to do the next thing, which was to bring in this horrific, what was the name of the act again? The Patriot Act The Patriot Act. Now, from euphemism central, here comes the Patriot Act. The only trouble was it had been written years before and was actually outlined in documents that came out of the conservative think tanks leading up to the election of George W. Bush, known as PNAC. So all of this was a script taken right out of the playbook of all the big players who eventually came into power in the 2000 election. Now, I say all that to say this, that we cannot afford to operate on our post-traumatic stress syndrome anymore. We have to get over it. We have to do what people do. We have to deal with those fears, confront them, confront the emotional trauma that we were inflicted with, and then we have to confront the situation from the standpoint that the law really does not allow this to happen. The military has no right to ask, and I don't care whether it's a city council, the board of governors of a county, or the city, whatever it is, whatever government institution, they don't have any right to even ask to be on the streets of America with a military presence.
Agree.
It violates our basic tenets of freedom. There is no causative instance in which we have to be visited by the military in our streets except for tyranny.
Now, I would like to ask you a question. I don't want to put you on the spot because there's really no wrong answer to this question. But once you give me your answer, I'm going to tell you exactly what I feel and what I can actually back up. What would you feel in all of his tenure so far as president, POTUS, is Obama's biggest failing and most treasonous action?
Wow, where to begin?
That's what I said. There's no wrong answer to this.
Yeah,
and
there
it's
really
a matter
isn't.
Of perception. Would you like me to skip over that and not put you on the spot and tell you what it is?
Sure.
Okay. It is failure to seal the southern border of the United States. Presidents have very few enumerated powers. As a matter of fact, executive orders to all of you listening, open your ears, clean the wax out right now. A presidential executive order applies to nobody outside of the executive branch of the government. Nobody. Not you, not me, not anybody. So when he writes an executive order and tells the country this will be law, poppycock. It is not law.
10 square miles of Washington, D.C. and territories.
That's it.
Puerto Rico, Philippines.
Yep, Guam. Yep, and a few other minors. Okay, mm-hmm. But so executive orders are not laws, and they do not apply to us. But most Americans are so freaking ignorant they cannot understand that. But the enumerated powers given to the president are very few, and one of his most ardent powers, the one that he is put into office to take care of and look after the most, is to protect the United States sovereign territory from invasion. He is to protect the sovereignty of the United States. Now, let me explain why he has failed so miserably and why this is so treasonous. There are estimates ranging anywhere from 15 to 25 million illegals have crossed the border through what is considered to be one of the most porous borders on the planet. I can show you border agents who are told to stand down, border agents who are pulled away and told to leave their gates open. I can show you miles of southern U.S. border where the fences have literally been taken down and the border patrol are told not to patrol them. Now, when you have between, and I'm going to tell you, it's probably right around 25 million illegals or criminals crossing the border. Who knows if they are murderers or they're rapists or they're drug dealers or they're terrorists, but they are by definition invading this country. And we have a POTUS who has one of his most ardent, one of his strictest enumerated powers is to prevent this from ever happening. And in the almost seven years he has been in the White House, he has done nothing to stem up that invasion. As a matter of fact, he has done just the opposite by rewarding those who cross the border with welfare, with medical, with places to live, with this man has committed treason in the highest order through his failure to exercise his responsibility to prevent an invasion of U.S. sovereign territory. I dare anybody out there to tell me where I'm wrong. I'm sorry.
Well, not to mention
actually,
the little.
I'm not sorry.
No, you're not. I'm actually, not. Let's not forget the little gun running operation that occurred down there, the called
Fast and Furious,
run by the right outside of the Justice Department.
That hasn't stopped.
No, it hasn't.
It just
stopped.
Got renamed.
Yeah. So we're not only in porous borders, we're arming the very gangs that will, in the days ahead, be used to inflame our cities, and you will begin to see the use of these weapons inside of our cities.
That's where I was going, and that's why I started with the southern border. Because now what we have is criminals who are being brought into, and I can't explain it any other way, being brought into this country, being bused or flown around the country to 191 cities across this country, being given a livelihood in which they are required not to be, they don't have to do anything. They're given houses to live in, they're given medical, they're given everything they need to live, and most Americans nowadays don't even qualify for. These illegals are getting, they're getting free education, they're getting free medical, they're getting welfare, they're getting housing, okay? And when the inflammatory portion of our soon-to-be reality starts, when the stock market collapses, when the dollar is worth nothing and the runs are done on the stores, let's figure what's going to happen. Let me give you a scenario. New York City or Los Angeles, either one, take your pick, okay? The first thing they're going to do is you're going to see a run on every store within that city. Those shelves will be bare, not within 24 hours, within 3 or 4 hours.
Yeah,
everything
absolutely.
Will be gone. Yeah. Everything will be gone. Restocking those stores will be almost impossible because most truckers won't even want to go into the inner cities, the ones that are even still on the roads traveling. What you are going to see is the military not entering those cities, but surrounding those cities to keep the gangs from marauding out of those cities into the suburbs and the countryside. You will see the have-nots forming up into gangs, and especially in these high rises, breaking doors down, taking your food, taking your guns, and anything else they feel they need to survive because they deserve it more than you do. You will see within the first, once this economy collapses, within the first 6 months, you will see tens of millions of deaths in the inner cities of America. This is not a guess.
No.
This, my friends, is a fact. And you will not see the military entering these cities because they can't win. There's not enough of them to go around. They will blockade those marauding gangs from leaving those cities. So if you're stuck in the inner cities when this economy collapses, stick your head between your legs, and unless you're a leprechaun, kiss your ass goodbye. You wanted to get dark? That's dark.
It's dark.
But it's also reality.
It's also.
Why does Roger live in the middle of Montana around nobody? I won't say it again. This is why I live here. Nobody's going to come marauding to my house.
And yet at the same time, you know.
I love the way you say that because I know it's coming. Go ahead, my friend.
Well, it is not too late right now.
No, I agree.
It's around.
I agree.
Even with Jade Helm, even with an illegal president in the White House, even with a reprobate Congress and a Supreme Court that's so degenerated and debased, they now rule on things for which they had no authority. The one voice that's not being heard in all of this is Joe and Jane, average American out there. The people who do work, the people who do support the system, the people who basically have been the bulwarks of this society for the last 150 years. But you haven't been heard because you haven't spoken up, and you haven't acted, and you haven't insisted that your police officers stick to the Constitution. You haven't gone and spoken to your city fathers when they've rolled over for the corporate money mongers who have come in and taken over your communities. You haven't stood up and demanded a better form of life and freedom from being poisoned in the air, in the ground, and in the water, because programmed ignorance.
Agreed.
So we're breaking the programmed ignorance. This is the first step, but you have to do something. I've told people in my own life and on this radio show numerous times over the years, well, what do I do about it? Did you get a speeding ticket? Were you cited by your township for something wrong with your property? Did somebody screw with you somewhere? Have you bothered to do anything than write a damn check to pay the fine? Let's start there. Let's start with the fact that they can't possibly manage a court system if everybody that got a ticket just walked in there and pleaded not guilty. You don't need to know the law at that point. You simply have stood up. I'm taking that as a base level to say, when you start to think strategically, there are a myriad of things that we can do on an individual day-to-day basis to pull this thing back from the brink. The collective of that is a very powerful message to the government that goes, ooh, the natives are getting restless.
Yeah. One of the first things you can do when you walk into court is tell them, you actually have no authority over me because I'm not a citizen of Washington, D.C. I do not recognize a foreign power's control over my citizenship right. in the United States, of the Constitutional Republic of the United States of America. Would you be right? Yes, you would.
Yes,
are they going to agree with you? No, they're not. But I got to explain something to you. If a couple hundred thousand of us across the country walked into court and said, I don't recognize your authority because you have no authority over me, and you need to prove whereby you do, and they cannot prove it. They cannot prove they have any authority over you, because down deep, every judge and every lawyer within that system knows they have no authority over us. But as long as you believe, as long as you buy into the system that says we have authority over you, then they do. So what Randy's saying is so apropos. You need to stand up and say, what you are doing, what you are saying has no place within the realm of we the people. It has no place. I need to tell everybody out there, the biggest problem we have today is not our government. The biggest problem we have today is not our military. The biggest problem we have today is not big pharmaceutical. The biggest problem we have today is we the people. You cannot place blame unless you're willing to accept it first. When you want to realize why this government has gone down the shitter, look in the mirror. At any point in time, the people could have stood up and said, we've had enough. There's 310 million of us. There's about 50,000 of you. Who do you think is going to win this fight? And until we do, they're going to keep pushing the margin. So the next time you rail at your government, the next time you rail at your police officers, the next time you rail at the big corporations, look in the mirror and say to yourself, I am the biggest reason we have these problems, and I'm not going to be a part of that problem anymore. Once we place the blame on ourselves first, then we have the right to place the blame on them next. Yeah, see, you pushed the right button there.
Amen, brother. Amen. I think they get the point, and hopefully...
well, I got spit all over my monitor now.
Look, there's a website called thelibertybeacon.com. You need to go over there and read that. And every day you will get your appetite whetted by the people who write there.
Yes.
You can go over and hear the radio shows that are done. We have our own little radio station called the Town Crier, TLBTownCrier.com, the Liberty Beacon Network. where
yes.
We publish interviews, and those interviews wind up in the body of posts on the Liberty Beacon. So you have a multimedia outreach. You can read articles, you can listen to audios, you can view videos. We are hitting this multifaceted in every way to try and drive the message home. So, you know, yes. that's what needs to happen. And I'll just leave it by saying that there is something every day you can do. They fear you waking up right now.
Yes.
They fear that worse than anything else, because yes. it's taken them over 70 years now to drive you to the curb and make you a sniveling mass of noodles. And in 3 minutes of waking up and standing up, you send a message to them. As our friend in network once said, I'm mad as hell and I'm not going to take it anymore.
Well, I have a saying that I put on. I make up memes. There's a page on the Liberty Beacon called Reality Bites. If you go to the Liberty Beacon, which is our main website, it was our flagship, our very first website, all the way up at the top, there is a black bar, and in that bar, it lists all of the pages. The one all the way on the right is called Reality Bites, and I make up memes. These are sayings that I feel will strike people. It's an entire thought, an entire conversation in about 15 words, okay? And I call them memes. But on the bottom of a vast majority of them, I put this. I finished them off, a vast majority of them, with this. Stand up together, speak in one voice, and live free. And this is what we need to do. We need to unify our voice. We need, the first off, there are so many liberty oriented organizations spread out across this country and across the world, and they all figured they're doing something good. And in a vast majority of the cases, they are. But they're all proprietary, and they all don't want you stepping in, or a vast majority of them don't want you stepping in their yard. You go do what you're doing over there. Let me do what I'm doing over here. Let me explain something to you people. That don't work. We need to lock arms. I don't care if we're not all walking on the same path. If we're all walking in the same direction, we're going to form an avalanche. We're going to form a tidal wave, and we're going to walk right the hell over them. We don't all have to be saying the exact same thing. We just all have to be walking in the same direction. So when I run into a liberty organization that says to me, well, you say what you got to say and I'll say what I got to say, we don't have to. And the first thing I say is, you're part of the reason why we haven't succeeded as much as we need to up to today, because you don't want to lock arms with your buddies. We need unity badly. It's only through numbers will they realize they haven't got a snowball's chance in hell.
Yeah, let me just one more time push this as well. One of the organizations that's not doing that and is working closely with people of like minds is the National Liberty Alliance, John Duresh Group.
I love them. They're a partner of ours.
And what they have done in putting out these writs that they issued about a month ago, and we talked about this a couple of shows ago, Roger.
Yep.
Is they have fired a legal salvo across the bow of every government agency in this country. Over a million pieces of paper
yes.
have emanated from the National Liberty Alliance, going to every level of government, from the office of the POTUS to the Supreme Court to the Congress of the United States down to the local sheriff.
To the Joint Chiefs of Staff.
To the Joint Chiefs of Staff.
Well, I will tell you that the National Liberty Alliance, and that project was founded by John Duresh. They are very, very, John's a good friend of mine. They are a very close partner of the Liberty Beacon Project. As a matter of fact, we're their media arm, and we promote them very, very heavily. We rail against the tyranny, whether it's political or whether it is an political or whether it's health-wise. We have partners like Health Impact News, which is a network of health sites that pushes back against the health tyranny. When it comes to the judicial portion of this charge, that is the National Liberty Alliance, and my God, the things they're doing. You're right. This show would not have been complete without mentioning them.
No. I don't think anything is right now. So we've just given you a menu, And the menu is the Liberty Beacon, and you can go over there. The people that we are aligned with, the people that we are working with, the people that we write about and partner with are linchpins in the Liberty movement right now. Support them. Support these people that are doing this work. Support the Liberty Beacon. Support CCN. Because these are all media outreaches that allow you to connect with what's most meaningful to you. And my God, I sound like a PBS fundraiser right now. So,
but what you're saying is the truth. The thing of it is, you know what? Without people willing to step up, show their face, and put the word out, then the eradication of programmed ignorance, which is our mission statement, is impossible. We have to be able to get the word out via some mechanism, whether it is through CCN, whether it is through the Liberty Beacon Project, whether it is through John DeRash and the National Liberty Alliance, whether it is through Health Impact News. It doesn't matter. Each and every one in their own right is helping to eradicate programmed ignorance. What is going to hurt humanity the most is what we know the least about. If we know it's coming, we can put up one hell of a fight. If we don't know it's coming, well, one of the memes I made up is, for those who wish to bury their heads in the sand, reality is a persistent foe, and your awakening to reality is inevitable. The only choice you have is whether to meet it head on, awake and prepared, or through the result of ultimate tyranny. Which way do you want to meet it? Awake, prepared, and head on? Or a club in the back of the head, and as you're going down, you're going, WTF, over?
He who stick head in sand get ass blown off.
That's it. I call it the ostrich syndrome.
It is.
And more Americans suffer from the ostrich syndrome than any society on the planet. I actually wrote an article called Americans and the Ostrich Syndrome.
And I read that article. I remember. You know, we've burned through almost 90 minutes here, and we've barely scratched. You pointed out any one subject in itself would be a standalone show.
It would. We're going to have to do this again, but you're going to have to do it over on this side.
And we will do that.
Yes.
I would
love to come back to your network again, too. I really think you've got something good going here, Randy, and I appreciate it.
The people behind this, Mel and Biggie.
And Biggie.
They're visionaries.
Cheers to Biggie.
Absolutely. And to Mel as well.
And to Mel as well.
Yes, absolutely. Your background in the military and in the defense contractor field made you aware of things going on in the background that they're uncomfortable to talk about.
Yes.
And part of it is the hidden technology that has been burgeoning since the end of World War II.
Yes. Agreed.
The proliferation of what we call secret technology, black budget operations, we know, for instance, Roger, that the technology that we have today, whether it's the computers, the mobile phones, what we see, use, and know about is really ancient technology in terms of...
It's a minimum of a generation behind. 20 years.
Yeah.
20 years.
Yeah.
And, I would tell you that what you're looking at around you is... if I get something and I can use it with in a military aspect, and I get something that makes that obsolete... The first item that I had that nobody else had that I used as a military, as a weapon, or as a form of stooping or whatever, now becomes available to the public. It is poured out through these corporations that own the military-industrial complex as things like cell phones, like microwave ovens, like flat screen TVs. I've got to tell you, these things existed in the military long before we've ever had them. long before they knew they even existed. I can remember flat screen technology in the military long before anybody ever knew what it was, and we didn't talk about it. I can tell you right now, there are so many ways to kill you that don't leave a hole in your body that you will never know it's coming or never know what happened, unless somebody with a whole lot of knowledge does an autopsy and decides to tell somebody that your blood boiled away within the veins of your body, or that you cooked from the inside out, or that your brain was literally fried, or that you were controlled, literally controlled, by sound waves or by radio waves from a remote area, causing you to do things you normally wouldn't do. I would tell you that a census was conducted in the United States of America in 2010, where everybody was tied. Your front door was GPS not once, but twice. Every single front door in this country and who lives there was GPSed. Now, I can also tell you that the technology exists from either drones or satellites. If you step too far out of line, to give you an embolism without you ever knowing and without anybody stepping into your house and pulling a trigger. The only thing preventing that from happening on a wide scale today is that it's not as prolific as it will soon be. But is it available? Is it available to take out the Breitbarts? Yes. Is it available to take out the individuals where you sit back and go, why did that guy die? Why did that guy die? You know, I mean, he wasn't sick. Sure, he was running his mouth off, but why did he die? Well, let me explain something to you. If you can't pin a reason to that, well, I can give you a couple of real good guesses. And this technology exists. And 20 years from now, when something supersedes that, they will find a way for you to spend money on it, and you'll be using it in your house to help them in their genocide and help reduce the population of the planet. Did you know Wi-Fi has the ability to sterilize 50% of all young females that are exposed to it over an extended period of time? If your daughter is going to school and has Wi-Fi in her class over a period of 2 or 3 years, 57% of all of them females will either be totally sterile or will have a very small chance of being able to procreate. Wi-Fi is killing our children, and they've known this for 20 years.
Listen to what he just said. 20 years? Wait a minute. We haven't had Wi-Fi for 20. Wait a minute.
Yeah, we have. Mm-hmm. Yes, yeah. We have. The military's had that capability for quite a while.
This is how clever they are. They get us to fund them at both ends of the gamut. First, the tax dollars are used. They're filtered through private for-profit corporations. Well, the government itself is a for-profit corporation, don't forget that.
Yes.
Then they take their cast-off technology, they sell it back to us and use it weaponized against us to invade our privacy, to invade our biology, to use it as psychotronic weaponry to mind control the populace using this digital technology that's now in its next iteration, when the next iteration of this technology, in my opinion, is quantum, it is four-dimensional, it is nano, and it is being filtered into our system through our biologies even as we speak, because these nanite particles have been sprayed. Again, it goes back to the whole concept that we are just becoming weapons against ourselves. They've weaponized our biology against us.
Nanobots are reality.
Yes.
What a nanobot is something that is so small that it makes a hair look like a redwood tree. Okay? These can be injected into the human body or can be breathed in and will pass through the capillaries in your lungs like they're not even there. These have specific robotic functions or specific programmed functions to attack specific cells, brain cells, whatever, or to alter our basic DNA structure. I can tell you that all of the GMOs that we are eating, the genetically modified food that we are eating, the genetically modified chemicals being sprayed on our foods, nobody out there ever hears what I'm about to say, or very few people, and very even few of them know what it is. Let's talk about the ability to reach in and literally change your genetic code. This exists. We know that horizontal gene transfer, listen, I'm going to say it again, horizontal gene transfer exists. Americans and people across this planet that have been eating a steady diet of GMOs for a generation or longer now, our genetic code doesn't look like our grandparents did. No. And our children's genetic code doesn't look like ours did. And what we are ending up with is the inability to fight off diseases. Why does America have the highest level of autoimmune dysfunction on the planet? Why are we not immune to things we used to be immune to? Why? Because of horizontal gene transfer from the vaccines, from the GMOs. They are changing our genetic code. Within a couple generations, they're not going to have to come in and kill us. We're going to die off.
Yeah, we're being selectively breeded out of existence.
Yes.
And room is being made now. First, the mind-controlled, well-satisfied slaves, then finally the singularity.
Well,
we are being led towards a hybridization of human technology that will eventually make us something that is not human anymore.
Totally controllable.
Totally controllable, totally predictable, which is what they've always wanted.
Well, everybody knows, or at least anybody listening to your show probably knows, and a lot of people listening to anything the Liberty Beacon puts out probably knows, that the Georgia Guidestones states that in order to keep humanity in harmony with the planet, the population should not exceed 500 million people. Wake up, people! There's 7.5 billion of us! 7 billion got to go somewhere. Now, they are going to tell you over and over again that you need to call the herd because this planet is so overpopulated, it is insane. Let me give you a hint of what a big lie this is. You can take the entire human population and put it on a landmass the size of Australia, give everybody a big yard to go out and play in, every family, nobody would be crowded, and leave the rest of the entire planet open without a single human being on it. That's how overpopulated this planet is. What we are looking at is not overpopulation. This all started with Brzezinski about a generation ago saying it used to be much easier to control a million people than to kill a million people. Today, it is much easier to kill a million people than to control a million people. The fact that the elites feel they must cull the herd has nothing to do with an overpopulated planet. It has to do with too many people to control. So we must break that control before they break us. And on that, I take a respite.
A well-deserved one, I might add. You know, it just strikes me, Roger, that, you know, we keep coming back to the dark stuff, and I understand this is difficult for people to process, especially people who may hear this later on that haven't encountered some of these things. But again, this is part of the waking up process, is to realize what we're up against and realize that, you know, I have to say it, I always do. We are in extreme spiritual warfare, unlike anything I think has ever existed in history, at least not in the recorded eons of history. We are seeing an assault on humans. For what reason? And, you know, it is a battle of good and evil. It does have a spiritual component to it.
Yes.
You and I have talked about this. We're not religious men. But we are spiritual in the sense that we understand that this enemy that we're up against would ultimately take down the majority of humanity to conquer and control it. And I still, you know, there's a part of me that I sometimes go, what is the end game? what is the final movement that they want to precipitate? I toss that to you.
When a director of the United Nations stands up and says, nobody will be accepted, no individual shall be accepted into the United States, the New World Order, unless they first accept Lucifer. When a UN official stands up and says that, and that's a quote, anybody that wishes to, all you have to do is Google it. It will pop up in your face like so quick you can't believe it. Let's stop and consider, what is the end game? Well, first off, we started, one of the first things we discussed is this evil that they call the New World Order, okay, can't come into being until or unless the United States is brought to its knees. We're the cowboys of the world. We are the people that the world looks to say, well, if America is going to, if it's going to be done anywhere, it's going to be done in America. Yeah. Okay, let's stop and consider that the highest and the fastest rising level of infertility on the planet exists in the United States of America. We are the most vaccinated, the most GMO'd, the most drugged, the most fluoridated, the most geoengineered. All of this stuff is centering on the United States. We have the worst and the fastest rising level of infant mortality, okay, in the industrialized world. It should be exactly the opposite.
It should be,
okay?
Yeah.
So highest level of infant mortality in the industrialized world, the fastest rising level of infertility on the planet, and we know that the United States has to go down first. What's the end result? The end result is a society where, and this comes straight out of a science fiction novel, where you have 15,000-20,000 elitists with 500,000 programmed slaves to wait on them hand and foot for anything and everything they could possibly want. They feel that is the next level of humanity. They feel that we are holding them back. They feel until they rid the world of the virus called humanity, the cattle called humanity, and the elitist are all that's left with their robots to tend them, that humanity cannot reach the next level. Let me explain something to you. I feel it's exactly the opposite.
Yeah, we are basically looking, I mean, I don't even know what to say after that. We have a fraction of 1% of our population controlling everybody else on the planet, indirectly or directly.
Can I jump in for 1 second? I want to tell you something that most of your listeners won't be aware of, and this is going to shock the living hell out of them, okay? The entire gross product of the entire planet, all put together, everything put together, is a little over $70 trillion. Everything on the planet put together, the entire gross product of this planet is a little over $70 trillion, okay? If you take a look at the wealth of the Rothschilds, everything they own, every asset they have, every family asset, okay, that family is worth almost $110 trillion. If you take the entire debt of every country on this nation, it barely approaches $50 trillion. The Rothschilds could pay off the national debt of every country on this planet, allowing humanity to live a much better life and still have well over half of their fortune, the biggest fortune humanity has and will ever see. Now, when you've got something that gross, that grossly out of proportion, how can you tell me there's anything good about it at all? What I just told you is all true.
It is all true. And it is a sobering reality when you and I'm just pausing.
They could pay off everybody's debt on the entire planet and still have anywhere from $50 to $70 trillion left over.
And yet the reality of that is that the numbers are all fictitious.
Of course.
We don't have a valuation of net worth of one human life much less the lives of billions of people on this planet.
And my when all of what we call money is printed out of thin air, how can anything be valued properly?
The abstraction that is money is the sickness of the Western culture. I mean, it's obviously gone to the East. You know, look at China. Look how we pollute China now. Look what we did to Japan. Japan was conquered twice. First, they were defeated in war. Then they were nuked after they already declared an end to the war. Then we conquered them economically. We sent the Rockefellers over there. We poisoned their culture.
Yep.
We conquered them. We took all of the indigenous instincts of these people, as we have done everywhere that we have gone, and we bred it out of them until they're just, the Japanese now are simply Americans with slightly tilted eyes. And I'm sorry to say that, because I love the Japanese people.
And if you take a look at the Chinese, until they started to try and compete with the Western world, and believe me, I have nothing good to say about communist China, no. But now that they have Westernized their monetary system, their economy's on the rocks. China is hurting.
They are.
Bad.
Yeah. We did that. That was a planned implosion.
Absolutely.
And so at the end of the day, you know, this cancerous thing that we've called money is an unreal valuation on the root source of all that's good, which is the intellect and the work ethic of the people.
The most renowned weapon of mass destruction ever produced by mankind.
Much worse than the bombs. Much worse. Yes. We've conquered by financial tyranny.
Yes. We can get another hour of this?
We can, but not now, because let me tell you a secret.
I was pushing back against 2 hours. Remember?
It's nearing 4:30 a.m. in the Netherlands.
Oh,
and our
God.
Producer,
sorry, Biggie.
would really like to join his bride tonight in their bed. So I think...
Yes.
I think Biggie needs a good night's sleep. And
he'd probably send a missile over to hit my butt.
The fact of the matter is, you got the next 3 minutes to wrap it up and wind her up tight, buddy.
Well, I would tell everybody that's listening that I feel, I always feel privileged for two reasons. One, to have somebody like Randy that I can have a discussion with, knowing that he's not going to push back against everything and anything, because he is not one of the ignorant masses that we are trying so hard to awaken. Randy is a very well researched individual who goes far beyond even most people that I run with. So the second thing is being given a platform that allows me to say things, not only say the things I wish to say, but to say them with the energy and the, the balls I want to put behind them. I'm not one who's known to speak softly. No. I'm not. And I deliver my best message by springing forward and going, I dare you! So being given the platform by a special individual such as yourself, Randy, makes this such a special show for me that I push back against doing 2 hours with you. And at this point right now, I'm so revved up. I could probably do two more, even though I know we're not going to. But there's always the future, my friend.
There is. And it's an energetic dose that we'll get out there. That's part of what makes this so much fun. Is I get people on that have different voices. Your energy communicates your passion and your commitment.
Yes,
and so,
commitment,
you know,
yes.
To the listeners out there, this is a good thing. TheLibertyBeacon.com, it's coming up on the screen constantly as we're doing this. Go there, partake of it, reach out, see if you can find a way to support it, support what we're doing. We're in the last minutes of a race here, and the race is to save humanity. We don't have a lot of time. We need to push this now. We need to push it hard.
God, I could not have said that better.
And I want to thank you, my friend, Roger Landry, for coming on tonight. This is Off Planet TV. I'm Randy Moggins. The truth is out there. It's inside you. Find it, then stand up and go do something. We'll see you next week.